We are starting a brand new series, which I have shamelessly connected to things that are happening in pop culture. And if you haven't figured that out by now, you don't watch TV or use a cell phone, which might not be, such a terrible thing. But we're starting a series called Wicked, and it has absolutely nothing to do with the Land of Oz. But it does have a lot to do with some really good questions that people sometimes ask. And one of the most common questions that people ask, and I know that you've heard this and maybe you've even asked it yourself, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, that's not the question that I'm seeking to answer. That's a whole other thing, but the answer to that question has a great deal to do with how you define good in the first place, the sovereignty of God, and the reality that we rarely see the whole picture when it comes to God's plans. But when it comes to matters of good and bad, I believe that a much more interesting question is, can God use bad people to do good things? Over the next few weeks, that's exactly the question that we're going to answer, but, spoiler alert, you're quickly going to find that the answer is yes. And so, to begin, we'll begin at the beginning. It's a very good place to start. We're going to be in the book of Genesis today. And that's where we're going to live today. So you're going to flip through a few chapters, but I'm not going to give you that excellent workout of back and forth from Old Testament to New Testament and all those fun things. We're just going to hang out in Genesis because the story that we're going to look at today is pretty lengthy, and we're going to make it through pretty much the whole story. I'm going to summarize some things for you and give you an overview, and then I would encourage you, if you've never read the story that we're going to read today, go back over the course of the next week, read through it. It's quite a few chapters long. There's a lot of ground to cover with it, and you're going to find more interesting detail that I'm not going to get in here today because it's not our focal point. But you might be familiar with this story. It's the story of Joseph. So Joseph was one of 12 sons who was favored by his father, Jacob. Jacob is also called Israel, and that's the guy whose name was changed to eventually, ultimately, become the name of the nation and the people of Israel. At the beginning of our story, Joseph is the youngest son, and he is the favorite. He receives some unique gifts from his father, definitely receives his attention, and he is the brother that the other brothers look at and think, "Ooh, I really hate that guy." One of the unique things about Joseph was that God gave him dreams and the ability to interpret those dreams. He had a couple of dreams that were a little interesting and sparked some things in his heart and in his mind. You ever have those kind of dreams that make you think about your future and all that you could be, all that you could become, what you could accomplish, how God could use you? These were those kinds of dreams. But these particular dreams, while they painted that picture for Joseph, the picture for his brothers was a little bit different. But he was excited. And so he goes and he tells his brothers about these dreams and how they showed that one day his brothers would bow down to him. Now, if you have siblings, you know what a welcome statement that would be from your brother or your sister. Needless to say, Joseph's brothers really liked these dreams that he was telling them about. As a matter of fact, they like them so well, they planned together to send him on an all-expenses-paid trip to Egypt. Not quite. That's where we're going to drop in today. In Genesis chapter 37, we'll pick up at verse 18. The brothers are out in the fields taking care of livestock, and Joseph has been sent out there by his father. And here's where we begin at verse 18. They saw him from afar, and before he came near to them, they conspired against him to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we will say that a fierce animal has devoured him, and we will see what will become of his dreams." But when Reuben heard it, he rescued him out of their hands, saying, "Let us not take his life." And Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but do not lay a hand on him." Now, how you throw a guy in a pit without laying a hand on him, I don't know. Reuben's plan's a little flawed in that regard. "Don't lay a hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand to restore him to his father." So the idea is, yeah, we're not going to kill him. We're going to teach him a lesson. We're going to throw him in the pit, and then, you know, maybe we'll drag him out eventually, and he can be taken back home to dad. Verse 23, "So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the robe of many colors that he wore, and they took him and threw him into a pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat. And looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels bearing gum, balm, and myrrh on their way to carry it down to Egypt." Light bulb. We have an idea. Verse 26, "Then Judah said to his brothers, 'What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother, our own flesh.' And his brothers listened to him. Then Midianite traders passed by, and they drew Joseph up and lifted him out of the pit and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 shekels of silver. They took Joseph to Egypt." So they didn't kill him. They sold him. And as an older brother to a younger sister, I understand the desire to do that sometimes. This was pretty wicked, though. They looked at the favor that was on their brother, and in their hearts, collectively, couldn't stand it anymore. Sibling rivalry is one thing. But when you look at your brother or your sister and their position in life, the favor that rests upon them, when that drives you to anger and spite and hate and even violence or human trafficking, you've crossed a line. It's hard to admit it. And it's painful to see it. But even today, sometimes we do this. We look at our brothers or sisters, and jealousy, envy, spite wells up in us. And we might not grab anybody by the neck and throw them in a hole in the ground, but we'll sure do a good job of digging a hole to throw them in with our words, maybe. We'll do a great job of digging a hole to throw them in by the way we treat them, ostracize them. neglect our rightful Christ-like responsibility to love them like Jesus. Joseph's brothers crossed that line in a way that maybe we won't, but the position of our hearts sometimes is a little too similar to the position of the hearts of his brothers. But once in Egypt, Joseph is purchased by an official named Potiphar. And he is eventually given charge over Potiphar's entire household. He's the number one guy, managing all of the household affairs, making sure things are going right, that all the other servants and slaves are doing what they are supposed to be doing. Joseph showed himself worthy of that position. He excelled in many ways. Some of those ways he had control over. Some was just good genetics. Because scripture tells us in Genesis 39 that not only did he have the favor of Potiphar because he excelled, but he also caught the attention of Potiphar's wife because he was a smoke show. He was good looking. And in Genesis 39, he's going to meet somebody else who's a little bit wicked. Genesis 39, verse 7, and after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And as she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not listen to her, to lie beside her or be with her. But one day, when he went into the house to do his work and none of the men of the house was there in the house, she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house. And as soon as she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled out of the house, she called to the men of her household and said to them, "See, he has brought among us a Hebrew to laugh at us. He came into me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And as soon as he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and fled and got out of the house." Then she laid up his garment by her until his master came home. And she told him the same story, saying, "The Hebrew servant whom you have brought among us came in to me to laugh at me. But as soon as I lifted up my voice and cried, he left his garment beside me and fled out of the house." Now, yes, Joseph was in a position of favor with Potiphar. He was given great authority in that household, but you have to remember that he was a slave in a wealthy official's home. He didn't hold the position of a son. He didn't sit in a seat where he was above the law or the rule of the house. He was in every way subservient to Potiphar, his wants, his desires, his commands, and his judgment. So this was never going to go well for Joseph. So he is falsely accused by Potiphar's wife, and because they take her word for it, Joseph is unjustly imprisoned. While he's locked up, Joseph meets two men who have each had dreams that trouble them. One is a baker and one is the cupbearer for Pharaoh. They explain their dreams to Joseph and say, but help us understand. We're disturbed by these things. What could this mean? And Joseph basically says, well, I've got good news and bad news. To the cupbearer, he says, you are ultimately going to be restored to your position. You're going to get back to where you were. Life is going to get back on track. Everything's going to be sunshine and roses and wonderful for you. You're getting out of here. And to the baker, he says, well, you're going to get out of here too, but in a pine box. Your dream, my friend, means it's curtains for you. And these things come to pass. The baker is put to death. The cupbearer is restored to his position. And he is so elated to be back in his position, back in life. He's so overwhelmed with joy that he forgets all about Joseph for a time. Joseph is left behind, still in prison, for a crime he didn't even commit. And he sits, and he waits, and he wonders, what comes next? I've had these dreams. I know what God showed me in these dreams. How am I going to get there from here? There's a story that I'll share with you briefly about a guy who's standing on one side of a divided highway. And where he's standing is across the divided highway from where he wants to go. Now, it's busy, it's a thoroughfare, there's a lot of traffic. And so he goes inside on the side of the road that he's on, and he says to the man there, hey, how do I get over there? And the response is, well, you can't get there from here. There's a way to get there. Just might be a little bit longer, a little more difficult, maybe even out of your way with some turns that you didn't expect to take. And the people that you ask, how am I going to get there, may not have all the answers. Different guy, different place, different story. He's out on a hunting trip. And he's looking for this piece of property where he has permission to hunt, and all he knows is that it's on Pine Road. And the part of the country where it is, roads are not very well marked. And so he's driving and he's driving and he's driving, and he cannot find Pine Road. And so finally he comes to this little bitty gas station in the middle of nowhere, and he pulls in and he gets out of the truck and he walks inside and he says to the older gentleman behind the counter, can you tell me where Pine Road is? And the man behind the counter says, no, where is it? People you ask won't always have the answers. So here's Joseph, waiting, wondering, without a lot of answers. By this point, I can imagine the questions that roll around in his heart and his mind. God, why did you let my brothers throw me in that pit? God, why, while I was in that pit, did you allow those slave traders to be happening by at that moment? God, why did you allow Potiphar to be the one who bought me once I got here? Why did you allow me to be in that position where there was no defense from the accusations of his wife? God, why? Why did you let me end up in prison? God, why? Why did you let that cupbearer forget about me? Why am I still here when I've done nothing wrong? While Joseph waits and wonders, Pharaoh has a dream. Now, he doesn't understand his dream, and in keeping with the theme, he is greatly troubled. And he's asking, anybody who will listen, what could this mean? What does this mean? I'm losing sleep. I can't eat. I am tore up over these dreams. I need some answers. And from out of obscurity comes a memory in the mind of the cupbearer. And he says, Pharaoh, I know just the guy for the job. When I was in prison, I had a dream that deeply troubled me. And he was able to tell me exactly what it meant, and the things he told me have come to pass, because here I am standing in front of you, back in the position that I was previously removed from. This is the guy. You need to get him here. He can tell you what these dreams mean. And so Pharaoh sends for Joseph. Joseph is brought to him. The Pharaoh explains his dreams. And in a nutshell, Joseph says, it's a warning. It's a warning for Pharaoh. See, there's 7 years of abundance, 7 years of plenty that are on the way. It's going to be a tremendous time of harvest. More than enough than you could need here in your kingdom. But after those 7 years, 7 years of famine like you've never seen before. Pharaoh hears it, receives it, believes it, and then says, we got to do something about this. And he's so impressed with Joseph that he has now lifted Joseph out of prison and put him in a position of power in the palace. If Pharaoh is like the president, Joseph becomes like the vice president. He is the number two guy in charge. And his primary focus is managing the resources of Egypt through the 7 years of plenty so that he has resources to manage in Egypt during the 7 years of famine. And he excels at this. So much so that people from foreign nations who also experience the impact of the famine will come to Egypt to receive what they need. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. Let's drop back in Genesis chapter 41. We'll pick up at verse 46. Genesis 41, 46 says, Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land of Egypt. During the 7 plentiful years, the earth produced abundantly. And he gathered up all the food of these 7 years, which occurred in the land of Egypt, and put the food in the cities. He put in every city the food from the fields around it. And Joseph stored up grain in great abundance, like the sand of the sea, until he ceased to measure it, for it could not be measured. So we've got these massive storehouses full of grain, full of food, a supply that's more than enough to get through those 7 years of famine. And the famine does come, and those foreign nations begin to come in to Egypt seeking help, seeking food, seeking support, seeking rescue. And among the people who come into Egypt seeking these resources are Joseph's brothers. And if you don't know the story, at this point you're like, ooh, this is the good part, revenge. And if that's what you're thinking, you're going to be surprised. The brothers come. They come before Joseph and they don't recognize him. And they ask for assistance. They ask for help. They talk about back home. They talk about their father, who's still back home. And Joseph's heart leaps at the realization that his father is still alive, still out there. And there's an opportunity here for a reunion. Joseph supplies what they ask for, but he begins to devise a plan because he wants that reunion. He wants the family back together again. But before he's ready to jump headlong into that, he needs to know if these brothers are still the same kind of people that threw him in the pit. And so he devises this little test just to see what they will do if the now youngest brother is implicated in a theft. And so he has these sacks of grain filled for them to take back home with them, but he instructs the guards who are working with him to take a silver cup, a silver chalice, and put in the top of one of the bags that will be carried by the youngest brother. And then before they can get out of Egypt, he has them stopped. The cup is found. And the youngest brother now stands accused of a crime that he did not commit, that potentially could not only have all of the assistance that the brothers came to get stripped away, it could cost that brother his very life. Joseph remembers these brothers as spiteful, bitter, hateful, harsh, and selfish. Is this who they're going to be? Are they going to hand the youngest brother over now? Are they going to leave him to his fate as a thief? Much to Joseph's joy and delight, that is not the case. They intervene, they plead for the youngest boy, even offering to take his place. And so moved by their reaction, Joseph reveals the truth of who he is to his brothers. And I can only imagine the lump that formed in every one of their throats. Hey, look, Joseph's not dead. How are we going to tell Dad? And what's he about to do to us anyway? But quickly, Joseph says, you don't have anything to worry about. I've got you. Genesis 45, picking up at verse 5. Joseph speaking to his brothers. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Do you see the number of times in there that Joseph says, you didn't send me here? Can God use bad people to do good things? Surely. Surely he can. God used the spite, the hate, the anger, the selfishness in the hearts of Joseph's brothers. He used the wickedness of slave traders who were willing to buy another human being. And he used the same thing in Potiphar and his wife. He used the wicked, lying words of a lustful woman. He used the confines of a prison cell and the dreams of a convicted criminal and an innocent man. He used the worry and the distress of a pagan king. He used all these things to bring Joseph into the land of Egypt ahead of time. So that not only the place, but the people could be prepared. Not just to be rescued from a famine, but to be the beginning of a much greater work that God would do. Joseph's entire family, the brothers, their wives, their children, and his father and his wives, they all move to Egypt. And they live out the rest of their days there in Egypt. Among them, the first to die is Jacob, Israel, Joseph's father. And when he dies, the brothers still have this lingering fear that maybe he was just playing it cool until dad died, and now we're really gonna get it. But in Genesis 50, verse 20, upon the death of his father, Joseph says these words to his brothers. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Joseph, by this point, has a firm grasp on the reality that God has used the actions of wicked men to do a good work. As a matter of fact, it wasn't just about saving his family. It wasn't just about saving Egypt or any of the surrounding countries. What God did by bringing Joseph to Egypt was set the stage for the beginning of a nation. Not just any nation. A nation unlike any other. Not because of their physical kingdom or presence, not because of the land that they would eventually possess. No, the nation that he preserved by bringing Joseph into the land of Egypt was the conduit through which the Savior of all people would come. Far removed from their minds was the idea that one day, by throwing their brother in a hole in the ground, God would save the world. Can God use bad people to do good things? Surely he can. And as we continue this series, you will find how deeply true that yes is. Would you stand with me today as we pray? Father, we thank you. We thank you that even when we are not good, you are. We thank you that when we make selfish, destructive, spiteful choices, you can still use those things for good and for your glory. And God, we thank you that in the story of Joseph, we get to see how faithful you are, how intentional you are, and have always been about seeking and saving all who would come to you. We thank you, God, that in those moments in our own lives when we have found ourselves in a pit or in a prison, you have been faithful. You have been good. And you always will be. And God, we thank you that in those moments in our own lives when we've been the people throwing others in the pit or in a prison, you've been faithful. You've been good. And you always will be. And we thank you that you are a God of grace, of mercy, of forgiveness, of restoration and redemption.
You're not just a God who can use bad people to do good things. You're a God who can use sinful people to do godly things. You are a God who can use anyone and any circumstance for your glory and for our good. We thank you that that is who you are, that you never change. So no matter which side of this story we find ourselves on today, Jesus, would you stir within us the truth of how good you are, what you have done for us. Help us remember that no matter how many times we fall, no matter how many times we fail, no matter how dark our days may seem, you are always right there, faithful to forgive, to restore, to build us back up. Over and over again. We thank you that that is who you are. Give you all the praise today for all that you have done, all that you're doing right now, and all that you have yet to do in the days ahead. We love you, we thank you, and glorify your name. It's in that name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Hey, I hope that you've been blessed by this word, encouraged or challenged in some kind of way. If you are joining us for the first time, remember that the experience does not end here. I want to invite you to visit lifesongfamily.org/connect and fill out that digital connect card so we can get to know you better and find out how we can serve you and your family better here at Lifesong Family Church. Of course, be sure to like and follow us on Facebook. You can find us on Instagram and Twitter as well, so you can keep up with everything that is happening here at Lifesong Family Church. And as always, as you are able, we invite you to join us in person right here in Lewisburg, Tennessee. We can't wait to see you.